Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of the Body Wisdom Podcast. We are your hosts, Kiara Orbe and Gabby Barboza. Welcome, Jensen, to the show. Thanks for coming.
Hello. Thank you so much for having me.
I am so excited to get into this conversation today because we all know that a lot of our audience is very interested in HTMA testing. So I'm excited to break it down because I only found out about HTMA testing like 2 years ago, and it has completely changed my life. I'm super grateful for this test. It's extremely validating. So why don't we begin by explaining what HTMA testing is?
Yeah, absolutely. So I apologize, first of all, if you can hear the Navy outside of my house right now.
I don't think we can hear it, but that's okay, hilarious.
I just happen to live in like the flight zone. And of course, there's flights going overhead right now, but I'll ignore that. Heritage and mineral analysis. So I completely agree. I hadn't heard of it until a couple of years ago myself. When I graduated from the NTA program, I didn't know that we even as a health practitioner, that we had access to testing. And with my own story of getting through like magnesium, like totally changed my life. And I stumbled upon hair tissue mineral analysis testing afterwards. And I was like, whoa, like this is awesome. So basically hair tissue mineral analysis, it is a soft tissue mineral biopsy that provides a reading of the mineral deposition in the cells and the interstitial spaces of the hair over a 2 to 3 month period. So basically what that means is we're using a sample of hair. It's more than just a single strand. I always like to make sure that people know that it's not just like pluck one hair and send it in, that we need more than that. We need about a teaspoon of hair. And the lab is able to analyze the heavy metal and mineral content in that hair. And we're able to use that information to understand the heavy metal and mineral content in other tissues in the body. And this is really important because there's no other way to get this information. We can test blood, we can test urine, we can test stool, but we can't test tissues. Like there's no easy way to get a biopsy of tissues. And so it gives us really interesting information. We do have to read it in a different way than a typical lab report because it's what's being excreted into the hair at that time, during that time period. And it gives us about 2 to 3 months worth of data because we're taking like the first half inch or so of hair growth closest to the root. So it gives us like a broader amount of information than like a single moment in time for, again, blood, urine, stool, that you get like that one time chance. And so, I always like to make sure that people know that it's a screening test. It's not a diagnostic test. So we don't use it to obviously diagnose any sort of disease. Mm-hmm. It just gives us that different window into the body that we can't see in any other way.
Right. So when we're looking at the HTMA, it tells us mineral status, and then it gives information about heavy metals. How does that then kind of guide us on what we would do for someone's symptoms? Like, what does the HTMA tell us? What it would be like in a breakdown of maybe one area that it would tell us information about?
Sure. So, I mean, minerals are essential for all life. Like they are needed for every single enzyme reaction in the body. And so it's, you know, we always talk about like root cause, like minerals are at the root of literally everything that we do. And so for example, like mineral, I always like to say that they're like the spark plugs of the body. They are involved with enzyme reactions, contracting and relaxing muscles. So that's not just like going to the gym and lifting weights. That's like your heart is a muscle. And so the contraction and relaxation of that, nutrient transfer, nerve conduction, pH balance, all of these things that are just fundamental. And so if your minerals are imbalanced, you likely are experiencing some sort of symptom because of that. And so it's also really important to say that every single mineral affects every other mineral in the body. So they are either antagonistic or synergistic with each other. And so we look at HTMA results as a whole. We look at like different ratios between different minerals and different patterns that are showing up in the minerals. So we're not looking for what is your calcium number? Do you need more calcium? It's like, okay, if your calcium number is high, but this is also high, this is what it tells us. And so it can give us information about everything from digestion to blood sugar, thyroid health, adrenal health, detoxification. I mean, it's like the broadest test, I feel like, that's out there that just gives you this overall picture because of how important each, like all these different minerals are for different systems in the body. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that's what I love about it so much. And what I try to explain to clients is that these are the foundations. So the same way that we're working with the foundations that the NTA taught us, digestion and blood sugar, if we can also get data points to tell us, okay, this might be why you're experiencing this. And that's what I love about your app is that you can plug in exact symptoms and then it's telling us the exact result on the mineral test that is like similar to what that symptom is.
Yeah.
And I think clients love to see that. And I love to see it for myself. I actually just sent in a test as well. And I'm so excited to get it back because it's like, okay, that gives me a reason instead of, oh my gosh, what are these thousands of things that this could be? That could be the reason for this symptom that I'm having. And then tracking the progression over time. So because this lasts 2 to 3 months, then you really have that dialed in look versus this really bird's eye view of, did this happen years ago? Did this happen now? Or maybe it's a progression, but at least we have what the last 2 to 3 months look like.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's so interesting to see how when you put a client on a protocol based on their HTMA results and then being able to test, you know what they were doing over those past 2 to 3 months, what those changes were. And then you can directly look at, okay, so now the magnesium is much lower, which is good and shows that we're holding on to our magnesium better. And that all of these ratios are coming more into balance. And then you're also able to talk to the client about how their symptoms have decreased as their minerals have balanced out. So that's definitely my like favorite thing about the app too, is plugging in the symptoms and being able to see exactly in the results where do we look for that symptom inside the results.
I love how you emphasized the importance of minerals, because I think when you're at your doctor's office or just mainstream media, they're just like, don't forget to take your vitamins. And your vitamins are so important, but it makes me think of something like beef liver and how many fat soluble vitamins are in there, but there are also like a lot of minerals in there as well. Could you talk about the relationship that minerals have with vitamins?
Yeah. So, I mean, that's like a huge topic, but basically there's antagonistic minerals antagonistic and synergistic minerals and vitamins. And so we have to have minerals to be able to use the vitamins too.
Yeah.
And, you know, I mean, I don't have like a chart in front of me right now. Yeah. Like, nothing I can.
So complex. Yeah.
But I mean, the main thing to know there is it all comes back to balance with those. We don't want too much or too little of any of them. And the minerals we can only get from our food. Vitamins our body is able to create. And so, but you need those minerals to be able to have for your body to be able to use those vitamins too.
Yeah. That makes total sense.
It's so crazy looking back to childhood really quick. When I hear the word vitamins, the first thing I think about is the Flintstone, like chewable vitamins. Oh, and I would eat them, but I would eat like multiple and I don't know.
Oh man. You know,
I feel like the gummy vitamins are like the Flintstone.
Yes, the gummy. They are the modern day Flintstone. They are.
Total garbage, but yeah. I think we're doing something good.
Yeah, I still get PSA, questions about them. I still get questions about them. Like, what do you think about these? And I'm like, trash.
I looked into the Flintstone vitamins pretty heavily a couple of years ago because I was working with bariatric clients, people who had been through bariatric surgery, because that affects their minerals so much and the absorption of minerals.
So much, yeah.
And my brain basically exploded because I found out that most of these bariatric doctors are recommending the Flintstone vitamin for still. Their, yep. And I looked at like the, you know, the ingredients in it, and it is nowhere near, I mean, you know, I don't know how much we trust the, I think it's like the bariatric medical association or whatever. They're like, they're,
breakdown. Yeah.
Yeah. Their main people are like, doing the research and saying what vitamins people after bariatric surgery need. And the Flintstone vitamin does not meet any of those criteria, but that is still what they're recommending because they say it's like digestible. And like, they're getting like 0.3% of certain vitamins that they need. It just didn't make any sense to me. And it I was like, why is this happening? It's just as one of those things just drives me crazy about the medical system.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Mm-hmm. Well, now we can move on to my test results. I'm so curious to hear what you have to say about them. I took these tests are like about a year apart. And yeah, it was very shocking to see the most recent test, which I took a few months ago. I'm actually due for another one. I still have yet to do it. But yeah, we can pull those up.
Yeah, I have them up here. And I actually plugged them into the app as well. And so I wasn't sure, if, are you going to be sharing, are you able to share them like in the show notes? Is that what you're going to do so people can see them?
Yeah, well, we can, I think you, if you want to share your screen now, I think you can for our YouTube viewers. Sure. We can do that as well. And then yes, we'll put them in the show notes so others can see.
Yeah. Just because I think it's interesting for anyone to see what these results look like, because they can be really overwhelming at first where you're like, okay, it's a super colorful report.
And there's a lot.
Like, yeah, there's a whole lot. And so it's always just really helpful to actually see it and all the information that we get. Do you want me to walk you through like what I look for?
Yeah, just bare bones basics for anyone who is not familiar with HTMA.
Sure. So what I like to do is I like to start by looking at the person's metabolic type. This is what helps us understand what dietary strategy is going to be the best for them. So your metabolic type is a slow one. There are slow metabolizers and fast metabolizers, and neither one is... you know, there's not like a perfect metabolic type. That's a question I get a lot.
Yeah.
And what we are looking for overall with everything related to minerals is balance. And so what this shows us is that you are likely burning through your minerals and everything at a slower rate than a fast metabolizer who may need some help like slowing down where they're burning through their minerals like too fast. And so you need help possibly speeding up. And so we can make dietary recommendations around the metabolic type. Slows typically need more carbs, more protein, and less fat. They don't do really well, especially with like a keto type diet. And they really don't need a whole lot of added fat. It's fine, like the fat inside whole foods, that's great. But just the like dumping on of extra cheese, extra oil, all of that, that's better for a fast metabolizer.
Avocado toast.
Yes.
Oh man, I used to do that all the time.
Yeah.
No wonder. While at the same time eating spoonfuls of nut butter and I felt like crap.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and then I always like to point out the first four minerals, in this purple area. These are the ones that we look at first. That's the most important thing on this test, because when these four, calcium, magnesium, sodium, and potassium are not in balance, literally nothing else can be in balance. And so we always have to focus on those macro minerals first, and then, that will directly affect everything else. In the pink area, we have the heavy metals. So we do not make any claims of like heavy metal toxicity or anything like that from an HTMA test. All this is showing us is what was being excreted in your hair at the time that you took this test. And so you could, you know, heavy metals are stored in your tissues for years and years and years, and your body is going to decide on its own time when it's going to be releasing or detoxing these. We don't force detoxification by any means. And so the main thing that I use this, the pink section for, is knowing if you potentially have any exposures to heavy metals in your life that you aren't familiar with, that you would never know. If you're like living next to a golf course, or you live next to a farm that's spraying pesticides, or that your water is, you think your water is filtered, but maybe it's not getting everything that we need out of it. And so your results are showing that you have some arsenic, some mercury, and aluminum. Now, knowing that this is a test that, or like a retest, we look at it a little bit differently, because I know you've been optimizing your body for the last couple of years working with this. And it's actually a good thing to see the heavy metal content to increase on future tests, because we know we're working on balancing the minerals, which helps excrete, helps your body naturally excrete more heavy metals. So your exposure to arsenic, mercury, or aluminum could have been, you know, mercury, for example, like you may have gone through like a sushi phase in college, where you ate a ton of tuna and you were exposed to more mercury than maybe you knew about. And your body is just now getting rid of that. So it doesn't mean you have an active exposure or that you're mercury toxic or anything like that. We use this information to ask questions and figure out, is this a current exposure, or could it be a previous exposure? And how can we just support the body to best continue to eliminate those? So with regard to those, Kiara, do you happen to know of any specific exposures that you've had to arsenic, mercury, or aluminum?
Well, I'm just thinking of like brown rice, like brown rice noodles. Not that I consume a lot of them, but they are like a part of my diet, and I do try to source like organic white rice. I soak and also cook in the pressure cooker and cook higher amounts of liquid with my rice. Mm-hmm. And then mercury, I'm assuming that's just like water or pesticide exposure as well, like with produce and not washing it well, or using tap water, or I never was a big like fish kind of gal, but I think the most, I remember there was a period a few years ago where I was going through a salmon phase and I was eating a lot of salmon, but I know that's a smaller fish. Tuna,
that wouldn't typically be a mercury source, I wouldn't think.
Okay. Tuna, like once a week. And I do get the, what is it? The albacore, like mercury safe, less mercury than other canned tuna. And I never like sushi. Don't really see that I have any of the other, I mean, production of chlorine. That's interesting. I mean, I spent like, I don't know if that's like being in chlorine or like the production of it. I don't know what that necessarily means. Cosmetics, probably. Like, I mean, Lysol, I've been around it a long time ago. Bleached flour, I don't eat gluten anymore, but I'm sure I definitely consumed a good bit of it growing up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's just, there's so many places where these heavy metals are just lurking. And yeah, if our body doesn't have the ability to excrete it, and energy to excrete and detox, and our livers aren't working, you know, optimally, they can build up. And so this is always, it's always good to just have this information, because sometimes we'll get a client result back and their arsenic is like all the way up at the top and you're like, whoa, where is this coming from? And so it's like a bit of a red flag. Aluminum, yeah, I know a lot of times comes from like if you eat out quite a bit, because a lot of restaurants use aluminum pans,
yeah,
and cooking on aluminum foil and all of that. Mm-hmm. So we just have to try to reduce our exposure to these. There's never going to be a point where we can fully eliminate every single heavy metal from our lifestyle, but as long as we're being aware of supporting our body, getting at the minerals it needs, because heavy metals bind onto the same sites. So for example, like zinc and cadmium have a similar chemical structure. And so if you don't have enough zinc, cadmium will bind to those sites inside your body in place of zinc and can be used as such. But cadmium is going to cause huge problems and you need zinc. And so if you have enough zinc, it kind of pushes the cadmium out. It's like, no, we don't need you. So, and then down here in the green section, these are like the micro minerals, the trace minerals. Again, we really just focus on these first four, and that directly affects these. Some of the interesting ones down here, lithium, that's a really interesting one when people are dealing with like depression, or like bipolar. And this is a very different, our recommendations are very different from conventional medicine, where it's like taking lithium is this, it's like in a really high dose. I've seen huge changes in clients with just a micro dose of lithium. It's completely safe. And then like titanium and zirconium, these are two that sometimes we see if somebody's using like conventional deodorant, or they like just had a filling done. And so it just gives us like, each one of these just gives us like little clues that's really interesting to know about the body. But what it all comes down to really, as you guys know, are the significant ratios. Each one of these correlates with like a part of the body is kind of the way that I look at it. So what we're looking at here, so the calcium to phosphorus, your calcium to phosphorus ratio, when it's really high, like it is here, it's showing that you're in a parasympathetic dominant state. And our goal is to get all of these ratios into this white area. So you do have quite a few that are, in the white area, whether, I mean, they're a little bit low, we would love to see these like maybe a little bit higher. But this one is obviously the standout as, being like off the chart. And so, yeah. This is what we call the autonomic balance ratio. So parasympathetic state. So that's like the rest and digest mode. But there's a healthy version of rest and digest and an unhealthy version of rest and digest, I'm sure as, you guys understand. So when it's high like this, I always ask like, has there been anything that has happened recently in the last couple of years or anything that may have caused you to kind of burn out, where you have like default, like you were in fight or flight for so long that you've like defaulted to this parasympathetic state.
Yeah. I think that starting a business is probably like really up there. On top of that, moving and trying to figure my life out. Yeah, absolutely. And that makes total sense.
Yeah. The NAK ratio here, this is another really important one. This is actually the most important ratio on the whole test. We want this to be at 2.5 or higher. And what this, I mean, it tells us a lot, but, it gives us information about protein catabolism and adrenal stress. And so have you, I mean, obviously with the moves and starting a business, all of that, would you say that, you've been experiencing like adrenal stress?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. The CAK ratio is the thyroid ratio. So when it's high, people are typically experiencing symptoms, that are hypothyroid type symptoms. So we, again, never say that we're diagnosing hypothyroidism or anything like that. But the symptoms correlate very well, because of calcium and potassium's relationship with the thyroid and, basically getting thyroid into the cell, or sorry, getting thyroid hormone into the cell and cell permeability. So, yours is not super high. I tend to see people's like really high. So this looks pretty balanced. I think on previous tests, has it been higher?
Yeah, it was higher.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And were you experiencing, symptoms? Yeah. Like cold,
I feel
hands
like,
and feet?
Yeah, I feel like all of my life, there's always been like the cold hands and feet, the anxiety, the what I always thought of like as a sluggish metabolism and like not tolerating carbohydrates well and just not feeling energized, that has definitely improved, I would say. I think 2020 and 2021 things started to feel better as far as that goes, but there's still like, I think what I'm experiencing now is probably just cold feet. My hands are warm. My hands feel warm, but my feet, they've just always felt really cold.
Yeah. Well, your ratio is pretty balanced. And so that's really good to see and to hear that you've had that progression. You know, you've seen this, those changes.
Yeah.
The zinc to copper ratio is, they call it like the hormonal imbalance ratio. It has a lot to do with copper imbalance, which is, you know, another huge topic, I'm sure, that you guys could maybe cover in a different podcast.
Yeah.
But, we don't really focus on this one on a first test for sure. We have to focus on the other, getting other ratios and minerals in balance before we start dealing with copper imbalance. But, a lot of that has to do with adrenals and bile. So yours is a little bit low there. The sodium to magnesium ratio is also known as the adrenal ratio. And like we said, so this kind of goes hand in hand, seeing that your NAK and your NAMG are both low are showing adrenal stress. And so what are you doing currently to support your adrenals?
It has gone up, which is awesome to see.
And sometimes it happens so slow.
Oh yeah. I feel like that's probably the ratio that probably takes the longest.
Yeah.
Especially if adrenals are super tanked.
Mm-hmm.
I think it was like 0.49 or something like that on my first test. And I was like, wow, how am I even functioning right now? Lots of whole food vitamin C, lots of salt. I support magnesium topically and also some mag glycinate, even some mag malate. But also, I think for me, I've always been curious about like why my adrenal glands are working so hard. And so then that's when I got into like nervous system work. And so I work with my stress physiology there from a somatic perspective. And I kind of just bring my awareness to them. And just by doing that, like, really quick physiology lesson, your adrenal glands are like in the back of your body and they sit on top of your kidneys and they're about the shape of a triangle and the size of a quarter. And so if you can just like imagine that in your mind's eye and imagining them maybe even pumping out cortisol and adrenaline and keeping you alive and doing everything that they can, to prioritize your survival so that they can keep you safe. Just even bringing your awareness towards that can do so much, and inviting them to soften and slow down just for that moment. And so that I feel like has been really, really helpful for me, because it's often not, I mean, you can speak to this too, Jensen, like it's not that you're not consuming enough salt all the time, like, or too much salt on the other hand, because I think my sodium was really, really high on this test. But yeah, like I eat a bunch of salt and I've been doing that for the past 2 years. And yeah, I think, I mean, there's a lot, I mean, I know blood sugar, balancing your blood sugar also has a lot to do with supporting the adrenal glands too. So that's been an emphasis as well, making sure, I'm getting enough protein, making sure I'm creating safety in my body through nutrition, has been a big shift in my life these past couple years.
I mean, I think you hit the nail on the head here. Like, we can look at all of these ratios, the minerals, and wish that it was just like, oh, I just need to increase my magnesium in my diet. I just need some more pumpkin seeds and like everything's going to change. And the reality is that minerals are so heavily affected by stress because we burn through certain minerals at faster rates when we are under stress. And then when those are being burned through, other minerals and vitamins have to compensate. And so it becomes this imbalanced system. And so it really truly comes back to stress and stress management. And that is, I mean, that's why it's so amazing what you're doing with the somatic work and all of that, because we can help people support their bodies with the right food, balancing their blood sugar, trying to get optimal digestion so that they're getting the absorption of the correct minerals. But if they're still burning through them at a crazy high rate because they're totally stressed, mm-hmm. it doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
And so that's like the deeper thing, the deeper yes. information that we can see here is the HTMA test gives us kind of a stress report of what's happening.
Yeah. And it can feel, I remember someone told me at the very beginning when I was trying to figure out my symptoms in 2016, and they told me like, you're stressed or like it's all in your head or whatever. And it felt very invalidating. So that's not what we're saying here. Like, but it's also really important to kind of come to terms with that and like ask yourself, like, where in my life do I feel stress? We all feel stress, mm-hmm. but a lot of us actually have a really poor tolerance towards it. And sometimes for a lot of the clients that I see, daily stressors can feel like 911 emergency and catastrophe. So it's really the response to stress mm-hmm. that we're discussing. Yeah.
And there's those external stressors of just living normal life. And then those internal stressors, like heavy metals, like what is our body being exposed to that is yeah. causing stress that we don't have a lot of control over. But if we can eliminate those sources from our life, that's going to help with our overall stress load.
Exactly. Yeah. I love that you brought that up. Stress can mean so many different things
yeah.
and it'll take time to peel back all of those layers. I mean, I think that's really important to emphasize here. Like, this is not an overnight process. It's been years since I've been dabbling into the realms of health and wellness, and it gets easier, I promise. And I think the more you can do to avoid overwhelm, or I guess the less that you can do, the better. Because it is such a slow process.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So just to finish up your results, the last ratio I wanted to go over is the calcium to magnesium ratio, which we've talked about, blood sugar a lot. This is the blood sugar ratio, and yours is a little bit low, which tends to show hyperglycemic tendencies. Mm-hmm. And so we would just want that to come up a little bit. But it is within that balanced range. But the closer to 7 that we can get it, the better.
What are some symptoms of hyperglycemia? Because I usually feel like I see hypoglycemia on HTMAs.
Yeah. So, I mean, the hyper and hypo both have similar symptoms, but it's basically just your blood sugar regulation. You're crashing and coming back up, and it's just, you want it to be so much more stable.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
So is this helpful?
Yeah.
I know you are the HTMA expert too, but sometimes it's fun to go through it together.
Yeah. Well, I think one thing that a lot of my clients, and I don't know if this goes for you too, Gabby, but they're always concerned about their thyroid when they come to see me, and they understand that it's running the show when it comes to our metabolisms. And so they're focused on that word metabolism, and it makes sense. And often find that everything comes back normal on a lab blood work with their doctors. And when they come and run an HTMA with me, not that we're diagnosing, but they do have that cellular tendency towards hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism. So can you kind of explain why that happens on an HTMA versus blood work?
Yeah. So basically calcium, the relationship between calcium and potassium affects cell permeability. And so you might be seeing that they are in from your blood results. It might be showing that you have plenty of thyroid hormone in your blood. But the problem is that because of the mineral imbalance, that thyroid hormone is not able to get into the cell to do what it needs to do. And so this can be just, I find it to be like the most validating ratio on an HTMA test, because the problem is that we're all going to the doctor saying, I have all of these symptoms, and then they run the test and then they tell you, oh, well, it looks fine. And then they don't have any answer for you. And this shows us something that we can do to help the thyroid hormone get into the cell more effectively. And that's typically increasing your potassium consumption.
Yeah. Calcium is, so I can't remember what my number was, but I think calcium shell is like 160. Was it 164?
165 is a calcium shell. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So what are some ways that you would typically recommend that calcium coming down?
Yeah. So we want to increase potassium mm-hmm. and decrease calcium at the same time, but that doesn't necessarily mean decreasing calcium consumption in your diet. Yeah. It's because, you know, calcium has so many cofactors for it to get into the bones where it needs to be. Effectively, we don't want calcium in our tissues. 99% of the calcium in your body should be in your bones and in your teeth. And so when calcium is high in the tissues, in the hair, it is showing us that it's not going where it needs to go. And so you might be eating calcium, but because of different hormones and mineral balances and vitamins and all of that, it's not going where it needs to go. And so the biggest thing that I see make a shift for calcium being shuttled to the bone is increasing your vitamin K content. Mm-hmm. So I typically personally put people on a vitamin K2 supplement or like a super K type supplement, mm-hmm. Because that directly helps calcium get into the bones. Mm-hmm. So yeah. If we can get the calcium out of the tissues and into the bones where we want it, that lowers the calcium in the tissue level. And then we can increase the potassium level, then that ratio decreases and the symptoms associated decrease.
Yeah. What are some symptoms associated with the high calcium level?
So with just a high calcium level, the symptoms, you can have like joint pain. So I mean, anything that's calcification, like that's the word, calcification. And so, a lot of times when people have high calcium in their tissues, they can like feel it in their bones, in their tissues. And once we start breaking that up and getting it back into the bones, they, it's like, they're not so achy. I think achiness is one of like the main things. But then there's also like a psychological component to calcium being in the tissues. And, so if somebody has had like trauma or something, calcium is very like protective mineral. And so people can be kind of holding onto calcium in their tissues as like a protective mechanism. And so there's the actual physical calcium in the tissues and then, breaking it up and seeing how it changes their psychological side too.
It's been so fascinating to see the calcium come back on clients that feel like they have a flat affect and don't experience a range of emotions, because those are the ones that I often see the calcium through the roof. And then they have kind of this thing, especially people that were taking birth control or something that was influencing their hormones as well, it seems that they notice that their emotions completely turned offline. Mm-hmm. And I remember that in my own experience too, when I stopped taking birth control, I weaned off of my antidepressants and also stopped taking birth control around the same time, which looking back, I was like, what was I thinking? But at the same time, I started to cry again. And I was like, whoa, this is great. Like I've been wanting to cry for years and I haven't felt like I could, and I couldn't force it. And so sometimes when you break up that calcium shell, you do notice the emotions coming back online, and it's really important to know that's normal. Yes. And you're not going crazy.
Yeah. Especially the crying. That's like a huge shift that people see, especially when their calcium is so, so high in their tissues and it starts to go down. They're like, what is happening? I'm so emotional all of a sudden. But I always tell people that it will regulate. Like you won't be crying constantly, but it is good to be able to feel your emotions again.
And what about if the calcium is like super low?
Super low. Typically your body isn't absorbing enough calcium. And so we would want to, typically if calcium is really low, then the other minerals, the other main minerals are also really low, which would put us in like a four lows type pattern. And that shows us potentially malabsorption in the gut, maybe something like a parasite or something that is making it where you're just not getting a whole lot from the food that you're eating.
Mm. And that's typically with like a fast oxidizer, no?
No, typically with slow, but you can see it with both.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. So on the note of thyroid function, what are your top three ways to support thyroid function from a mineral perspective?
Yeah. So like I said, adding extra potassium into your diet is really key because the recommended daily allowance of potassium is 4,600 milligrams. Mm-hmm. And there is no way we're getting that without actively focusing on potassium.
Yep.
It is truly difficult to get that much potassium, but it makes a huge difference when you start getting it. So that's why the adrenal cocktails are really helpful. I really like just coconut water in general, like having a coconut water electrolyte drink on a daily basis, because that's like 800 milligrams of potassium in one cup. So that's like an easy, like bang for your buck type thing. There is potassium in most whole foods. There's like a small amount. And so if you're focusing your diet on whole foods, you're going to be getting a good amount of potassium, but usually we need that extra boost of potassium. So like also russet potato skins are another big source. So don't shave off the skins, leave the skins on. So increasing potassium, eating enough food, I feel like makes such a big difference. So I know it's not necessarily mineral specific, but by eating enough food and enough calories and not thinking that, I mean, I'm sure your audience is probably mostly women, not thinking that we can just subsist on 1200 calories and be fine. That decreases the stress in the body, which also obviously affects the minerals. So I find that especially when the thyroid ratio is really high and people are experiencing those hypothyroid tendencies, like weight gain and all of that, it feels so counterintuitive because they think, I just need to keep cutting down what I'm eating. And they really actually have just like starved themselves into this, and they really need nourishment and enough calories so that their body can feel safe.
Right. And so often I think that people are eating so little based on our society and not realizing that it's impacting everything else too, like sleep. I actually have had a hard time sleeping lately, and I realized that I don't think I'm eating enough, not consciously, but just I was thinking back to my day of eating in the middle of the night the other night. And I was like, whoa, I did not eat enough today. And that's probably why I'm not sleeping right now. And we can kind of just see, okay, this is something that I can change tomorrow and it's okay. And also with not eating enough, there might be a day where you are eating so much because your body is trying so hard to get nutrients and you never feel full. And so when people come to me and they say, I'm eating 1200 calories and I'm not losing any weight, I often ask them or wonder, is there a day where you're kind of refueling? Mm-hmm. And maybe that's putting you over this calorie limit where that's preventing any fat loss, if that's your goal, because you're so imbalanced from day to day and your body is just holding on to safety whenever it can. So that impacts your thyroid too, because then your thyroid doesn't feel safe with your metabolism in the way that your those behavior changes. Yeah.
And then the third one that I just thought I would mention is making sure that calcium has what it needs to get into the bones, so that if you're increasing the potassium level and making sure that the calcium is going where it needs to go, those are going to be the biggest driving factors on helping your thyroid from a cellular perspective, tissue perspective.
And for someone who has hyperthyroidism, like would the recommendations be the same, or would they, I always get that question, like for someone who's running an HTMA, like, or they come to me with a hyperthyroidism diagnosis, they're like, should I be supporting it the same way? Like,
so typically if you're hyperthyroid, you have a fast metabolism from an HTMA perspective. And so what I would typically recommend in that circumstance is following the fast metabolic type diet. So we don't want to be focusing on carbs and protein so much. The fast metabolizers are going to do best on a higher fat diet. So not going as heavy into like keto, like I am not a fan of that for women really ever personally, but making sure that they're getting the majority of their calories from high fat sources is going to slow them down, and that will directly help the hyperthyroid tendencies.
Okay. Beautiful. Yeah. I think, food is such a charged topic, especially if you've been dieting for decades, and it can feel very counterintuitive to eat more fat or eat more carbs. when you are trying to lose weight or put on weight, it can feel very daunting and scary. And I think one of the things that I've learned and will always continue to remind my clients of is to go slowly. Because it can be so tempting to want to fix things right away and go from zero to 100. And I just don't think that our bodies, like we have to kind of move at the pace that our body is trying to heal at, which is very slow. Because otherwise going from zero to 100 can actually, and same thing with nervous system work. Like I think with everything, the concept of titration is just always to be at the forefront of any recommendation. So yeah, just wanted to shout that out.
Absolutely. Couldn't agree more.
Yeah. So, Jensen, where can we find you? What do you have in the works right now? How can people work with you? I know also a lot of our listeners are practitioners as well. So yeah, if you want to share a little bit about Instant HTMA Professional, that would be awesome.
Sure. Yeah. So I am not currently working with clients myself. Because my whole goal is training practitioners on how to use HTMA in their practice. But I have a few resources. I mean, obviously they could reach out to you if they're wanting an HTMA test done. You guys are amazing at what you do. But for any practitioners who are interested in learning more about hair tissue mineral analysis, I put together a super comprehensive guide that's totally free, and it answers the biggest HTMA questions that I hear. Just because I know that adding a new lab, or if it's maybe your first lab, it can feel super overwhelming. So I made sure that it covers info like if you're legally able to offer HTMA to your clients, the exact instructions that I send to clients on how to take a hair sample, and how to get an account with the only HTMA company that I recommend. There are a few places that do, I guess, what they call hair tissue mineral analysis, but there's a problem with a lack of standardization in this industry. And so there's one lab that I trust. And so I teach you how to get an account with them. And then from a business perspective, it also covers how hundreds of practitioners are using this lab to strategically attract clients and organically grow their practice. So it's called The Ultimate Guide to Adding HTMA to Your Practice. And I just hear from practitioners all the time on how much clearer they are about how to use the screening test to benefit their clients. But you can also find me at Test Don't Guess on Instagram. That's where I'm at on everything. So I have a Test Don't Guess Facebook group, Test Don't Guess on Instagram. And if you're looking to get an HTMA test done for yourself, I think reaching out to either one of you is really the best place to go. Because I know you guys will do like a full protocol based on results and follow up and all of that.
Yeah. Yeah. And really quickly, just wanted to talk about your app because, and the course, like the course that you've created has been, I've been through a couple programs that have touched on HTMA or have gone super in depth with HTMA, but I feel like the way you have designed your course and the app itself is just phenomenal, for lack of a better word. Like it's just so easy to understand and digest. You've broken everything down so that there's like no question. Like I really haven't had to ask any questions. And what I love also are the Q&A calls that you offer, the case study calls that you offer. So you really get to apply the knowledge that you're taking in from this course and kind of just talk about it amongst other practitioners who are in the same boat as you. So kudos to you, because I love talking about this app and have definitely talked about it with other practitioners who have then signed up for the app. And
yeah, the course definitely, it all started with this app because I was overwhelmed with clients and needing to do this a lot quicker and do the analysis a lot quicker.
Yeah.
And so it all started with the app. And then people who were using the app were like, we need a course. And so I broke all that down. And yeah, it's been really amazing. I love, love, love watching practitioners use HTMA with their clients, because not only is it a great, it gives us just so much information. There's so many labs available, and this one is just, it's affordable, and it's, it just gives us a wealth of knowledge about what's going on with somebody. It's a great place to start. And so I love supporting practitioners in that way and hopefully speeding up their process behind the scenes so that they know exactly. It just helps people feel more confident having that app that does all the analysis for you and looks at all these mineral patterns. Because when I was looking at them and I was trying to memorize all of this information, I was like, there's no way. There's literally no way I could remember all of this.
It's a lot. And it's easier to explain things to clients in layman's terms so that they understand.
Absolutely.
As well. The app is like this plug and play where you get the HTMA and you get to plug everything into this app, and everything kind of is, like you said, done for you. Cannot recommend it enough. And I think Gabby feels the same way. So
yes, absolutely. It's a game changer and really helps you have as a practitioner. I feel so much more confident and energized to have client calls, which is what I want to do, is when I'm on the client call, feel like I have a lot more space to hold for them versus spending hours and hours and hours behind the scenes. And then, yeah, it's a game changer for sure.
Yeah. So we'll put the link below in the show notes if you are a practitioner and feel that that is right for you. So that'll be in the show notes. And I think that's all we have for today. So thank you for listening.
Thank you so much.
And thanks for coming on, Jensen.
No problem. Thank you so much for having me.